In this video, we're going to learn about animal diets and digestive compartments, and then move on with a tour of the human digestive system. So we had learned about the four stages of food processing. Now let's talk about the different animal diets. Animals are heterotrophs. Or other feeders. We need to get our food by consuming other organisms. Now there are three main animal diets. Herbivores, are organisms which primarily feed on plant material. Carnivores feed exclusively on other animals. Omnivores regularly ingest both plant and animal materials. So let's look at a few examples of these types of organisms. A caterpillar is a good example of an herbivore. They eat leaves, they eat plant material. Conversely, you aren't going to find a cheetah grazing out in the fields or eating vegetables. They are carnivores. Their digestive system is specialized for eating meat. This is also true of their dentition. Humans have the body plan and the digestive system of an omnivore. We can regularly eat both plant and animal material and get nutrients from it. Now, it's true that some humans may choose to live as herbivores primarily, consuming plant material, and our digestive system is okay with that. However, we also clearly have teeth and a digestive system that allows for the consumption of meat. In animals, chemical digestion is contained safely within some kind of compartment, and this is because digestive enzymes are potentially very dangerous to us. It could break down the types of molecules that we are made of. At the cellular level, lysosomes are intracellular organelles filled with digestive enzymes, so they are the protective digestive compartments at the cellular level. At a larger scale, simpler multicellular organisms may have something known as a gastrovascular cavity. Now, a gastrovascular cavity is a digestive compartment with a single opening. That one opening functions both as the mouth and the anus for that organism. More advanced organisms have what's called a digestive tube. Digestive tubes have two separate openings, a mouth and an anus, that are distinct from each other. So here we see examples of organisms with these two different types of digestive compartments. Here the hydra, or freshwater cnidarian, it has a gastrovascular cavity, and so this one opening functions both as a mouth and an anus for that organism. Now, these hydra don't have taste buds in the same way that we do, so it's not quite as disturbing a concept for them as it would be for us. When we look at something that has a digestive tube, even something as simple as an earthworm, we see that there are two different ends to their digestive compartments. That one end functions in ingestion, or bringing food into the body, and the other opening of this digestive tube functions for elimination, or the removal of the feces, the unabsorbed, undigested material. So let's start taking a tour of the human digestive system. The human digestive system consists of a digestive tube. This is given a specific name. It's called the alimentary canal. The alimentary canal, it is the path that food takes as it's processed through our digestive system. So every step along the path that food takes, this includes our mouth, our throat, our esophagus, our stomach, our small and large intestines, these are all part of the alimentary canal. But that's not all there is to our digestive system. We also have accessory organs. Accessory organs are glands and structures which secrete materials into the alimentary canal, but are not directly a part of that path or tube on their own. This includes things like our salivary glands, our pancreas, our liver and gallbladder. These accessory organs secrete materials that aid in digestion. So here we see a diagram of the human digestive system, including the alimentary canal and the accessory organs. Let's take a tour of our digestive system, starting at the beginning, starting at the mouth. The mouth, or oral cavity, functions in ingestion. Remember, this is the process of bringing food into our digestive system, or it's simply another word for eating. Now, the preliminary steps of digestion. Also occur in the mouth. Now, the mouth is primarily a site of mechanical digestion, with the mashing and chewing and grinding of our teeth, although there are a few digestive enzymes in the saliva. And so, some of the carbohydrates might be broken down by these digestive enzymes. After food is chewed and ready to be swallowed, it is moved to our throat, or the pharynx. Now, the pharynx is what connects the mouth to the esophagus. The esophagus is the tube that eventually leads to the stomach. Within our pharynx, we also have our trachea. The trachea is the main windpipe that leads to the lungs. And so, it's important if we were swallowing food or drink to make sure that that food goes to the esophagus and not into the trachea. To assist us with this process, there's a structure known as the epiglottis. And so when we're swallowing, a reflex tips the epiglottis. To close the trachea's entrance, to close that windpipe's entrance. Now we've all probably had that situation where we're eating or drinking and then laugh or cough and somehow that epiglottis opens and suddenly we're choking, we're coughing on some sort of liquid or food that tried to go down the trachea. Now, even though those situations are uncomfortable, and we call that food or drink going down the wrong pipe, it makes us realize how many times we swallow and we don't choke and we don't get that food or drink headed towards our lungs. So really, the epiglottis does a great job. The next part of our digestive system is the esophagus. Now, the esophagus is a muscular tube. The esophagus is what connects the pharynx to the stomach. As soon as we swallow, that's the last voluntary muscular movement we have in allowing the food to travel through our digestive system. The esophagus is made out of smooth muscle, and so we do not have voluntary control over it. And instead, the food moves down the esophagus by means of peristalsis. Now, peristalsis is sort of a wave-like contraction that moves down the length of the esophagus. This happens because the smooth muscle contracts shortly after it is stretched. So when we first swallow food, it's going to stretch the smooth muscle in front of it, and then shortly after the food has passed it, that smooth muscle will contract. And in that way, it continues to push the food ball forward, directing it towards the stomach. In fact, this peristalsis is so effective, you could even hang upside down and swallow something, and it will still travel down the length of the esophagus towards the stomach. This is also the reason why astronauts in zero gravity can still eat and not have to worry about their food actually getting to their stomach. It's not gravity that's carrying the food down. It's peristalsis. In our next video, we'll continue our tour looking at the stomach and small and large intestines. See you in the next video.